Okay, well, let's see. First of all, she didn't tell you a couple of things about me, and one of them is that I love film. I absolutely love film. I study the history of film. And yes, that's boring. I understand that. I get it. But that's why I like to do it. So whenever we came and they asked me about whether or not I could be a speaker, I said, well, what's your theme? And so what is your theme? What was that?
Road to the Emerald City.
Road to the Emerald City. So what do you think popped up in my head?
Wizard of Oz.
Yay! So I'm all about film. And Wizard of Oz, I would go into long detail about why that is a very, very important film in film history. But that's not the purpose of this conversation. However, I knew that someone out there would be like, does she know that Seattle is the Emerald City? Yes, I do. Do I know why it's the Emerald City? Yes, I do. I even know the name of the woman that won the contest in 1982 that gave the name to the Emerald City because of its green trees and all this other good stuff. But you know what? That wasn't just that much fun. So I decided I was just gonna do my own thing anyway. Big surprise for those of you that know me. So here's my road to the Emerald City, okay? So how many of you were thinking of that whenever you saw the thing? No one? Anyone? Yay! I saw some green dresses, come on. Somebody was working with me. So I was so excited. I said, oh man, we really can go so far with this. And I was all about, I really like shoes. And so, yes, break them out. How many of you have ever had these shoes when you were growing up? Admit it, own it, yes. How many of you still have them? Owning it, yes. I was looking for them. Let's talk afterwards because I really have this great outfit that I need them for. And I thought, well, I will come up there and we will be talking about how we pave the road to success. And so how could we start this? And I was all about singing for you. What could I possibly sing for you?
Follow the elevator.
So I'm thinking I am going places with this one. So my husband is like, oh no, this is not good. And we happen to be going to Disney World, or was it Disneyland? Where were we? Disney World, and we happened to be in this great area we're talking about, and he was so gracious and let me go to the part of Disney World that talks about the history of film. So I was like, I can do this. This is going to be so great. Because as we think of the cast of characters, I know who these people could be, and I think you know who they are too. Rein it in, Lisa. This is not what this is about. I was like, oh, but I always have to be so serious in my real job. And those of you, and actually we have someone in here that actually works with me in my real job. Where are you, Lucas? Where are you, Lucas?
Yay!
So do I get to talk about Wizard of Oz at work?
No.
Not exactly. Somehow the political wants don't want to hear about the Wizard of Oz. Or maybe they do. But I won't talk about that. So, as my husband said, I better rein this in, and I thought, you're right. What was I thinking? Why would they ask me to speak? I have no idea. And I was thinking, maybe they thought I was a character in The Wizard of Oz, and that's why they want me to do this. So I started to ask myself, well, how can you talk if you haven't a brain? I live in Washington, D.C., okay? And, oh, some people without brains do an awful lot of talking. But in all seriousness, I really did realize, and I certainly respect the reason why you would invite me to come, and I am very, very humbled by this opportunity to be here. And some of you have approached me already, and I've met some of you before, and actually some of you I have met for the first time while I have been here. Some of you have read my book, Dulcify. A couple of weeks we were in New York. We were very excited. The book was awarded in three different categories: the Latino Literacy, the Latino Literacy Now International Latino Book Award. And so we won first place in design. Category for best photo cover, and that was actually taken by my daughter Katie, who is Legacy for Katie Kai. She is actually the youngest winner ever awarded this prestigious award, so we were very, very excited for her. The book also won an award for second place in most inspirational book and second place for best women's issues book. And so those of you that have read the book, you understand why this is very, very important to me. With me today is my husband, Mike, and I'd like Mike to stand because first of all, it will mortify him. Has been part of Katie Kai family. He's been Katie Kai husband for 20x years. We've been married 21 years. He was with me when we first went national in 1991 to help charter beta class, bringing them in. And so he knows all about Katie Kai. And shall I tell him what you call them, honey? Yes. He calls them my OMGs. Now, some of you weren't born whenever this little phrase came out, and there was a Saturday Night Live skit at that time. Some of you were. Can you help me out here? All right, somebody please help me. All right, so there was a Saturday Night Live skit about sorority life and the bowheads, and they're like, oh my God, oh my God, and they'd see each other, and they'd be like, oh my God. And he said, the oh my gods are coming over. So now he calls them the OMGs, and they all know it, and they love it, and so it is what it is, so, oh my God. But he has been with me for the entire journey, in my journey with Kappa Delta Chi, and so for me, the road to the Emerald City has looked very different than some of you, and those of you that read the book, I appreciate you reading the book, and those of you that haven't, I'm only going to tell you a little bit about it because it's not about the book right now. This is about Katie Kai and its role in my life and how the road to success has been here. Now, my road to success actually is very similar to some of you and very, very different than others. I have been very, very blessed in this life, and I have been tremendously humbled by the amount of success that God has afforded me and the sisterhood that He has afforded me and being able to rely on those friendships. Those of you that read the book know that I have a family of five children. I'm the oldest of five children. My mother's a single parent. My father's from Mexico, and my mother's here from the United States. But my mother raised me primarily as a single parent. I say that to you because it's important that we recognize the path that we come from in our lives, the road that we have traveled, because each one of us in this room, every single one of you in this room, has a very, very unique and special story. Mine looks different than yours in some ways, like I said, and similar in others. The lifestyle that I grew up in is different in many respects than some of you would think is very respectable. And some of you that have worked in the field that I work in now have an appreciation and a respect for the type of work that agricultural workers do. My family comes from a long, long line of migrant workers, and we move constantly in search of more work. One of the things that makes it difficult for agricultural workers, migrant workers, is that we do have that inconsistency in education. in addition to having that constant moving and living against poverty, English was not my first language. Add to that to the fact that my mother had an affair with a married man. When she had this affair with a married man and got pregnant with me, she had a choice to make. It's quite obvious which choice she made. I am quite thankful for her choice. And so, unfortunately, whenever you grow up in a situation like that, you are witness to many, many things that no child should ever see. As we moved along to the different places, people do as people do. They judge. People are very, very judgmental. People will judge you by the way that you speak, the way that you look, what size you are, if you're short, tall, fat, skinny, dark hair, light skin, dark skin, whether or not you have a disability, whether that's a physical disability, a mental disability, emotional disability. People make these judgments. People will also make judgments on whether or not you have two parents, one mixed, one not, one English speaking, one only Spanish speaking. People will make these judgments. My mother, doing the best that I believe that she knew how to do, made some really, really bad choices, as we often do, especially when we're under serious amount of stress and anxiety. We will tend to not make the best decisions possible. One of the things missing for her was also a very strong support system. When she opted to go ahead and keep me, she lost the support of her family. My grandparents disowned my mother when she decided to keep me. And so she went on to work, continued working in the migrant field by herself. Now, some of you might think that that would be a great thing for her to learn a lesson, get her life straight, but she didn't. Of the five children in our family, we have four different fathers, and that means we all had different last names. Now, that may not be important to you, but it is important to a kid who's registering in school, and people make decisions about who they think you are. People make these judgments. In the meantime, as you continue to make these bad decisions, we continue to move with her, work with her, go as she asks us to do, still teaching us important lessons in our lives about morality and what she believed would be values that would be important to us. And indeed, as many people have judged my mother, I love my mother. I love her very, very much. And I respect that she could do the best that she knew to do. I believe that in my heart. And those of you that have read the book, some of you have emailed me and asked me different questions about that situation. I can't speak for that, as no one can. And so she made a decision that she felt would help my grandfather accept her back into her life, into their lives. My great-grandfather had passed away. We were living in Chicago at that time. My great-grandfather passed away, and they sent a message to my mother, and they said to my mother, "We need you to come back for the funeral, but you can't bring those kids." I would be those kids. My sister and I would be those kids. And so she went. She wanted to respect my grandfather and his wishes. And she went to his home, and she said to him, "You know, I'm here as you've asked. I did not come with my children, and so I want to be back in the family." And he said to her, "Well, if you want to be a respectable woman, then you are going to marry this man who worked on another farm." And this man was considerably older than my mother. And so what do you think she said?
Yes.
Why? Why would someone say yes to that? He had five children of his own. He had been divorced twice before. Why would she say yes? Because what? She wanted to be accepted. She wanted the support system.
This is very, very important as we think about our culture, especially in our Latino culture. We think about the role of family and being accepted, making sure that we understand what our roles are, whether or not they are sexist in some ways. Sometimes doesn't play into our decision because we want to do what honors our parents. So she did marry him. She was so happy when she came back to Chicago to get my sister and I. She was so excited that my grandparents had accepted her back. What my poor mother did not know at that time was that she had just opened the door to a living hell. We went with her to Texas, and in the beginning, it was so wonderful and nice. I remember listening to Mexican music, to the corridos, to listening to just Vicente Fernandez, and great parties, and people would come over. And so what happens, I don't know if any of you are Mexican or not, I am. Do you know what happens at these parties? Anyone know? Drinking? Who comes to the parties? Who is invited? Everyone is invited. Do you get to send out invitations? Because remember, this is before e-bite, so how do we get invited? Word of mouth. And who are these people that are coming to your party? Who? Relatives. Your primo, your prima, your tía, and every week you get introduced to new primos, and then you're like, your tía, how's that, how she like to, what, has anyone been to that party? Yeah. And so how long does this party go?
3 days.
3 days, all weekend. When does the party end? When you run out of beer? When you run out of beer? Okay. So this is the first time in my young life that I have actually seen this type of behavior in all this family. And I'm like, oh, so this is what she was so excited about, all these people coming to her house and eating all our food. And something was really disturbing about the goat nailed to the tree. I still wasn't there yet, so but I learned about it. I'm good with that. Has anyone ever been to that party? Are you there? Are you my family? Are you my family? Yes, I think you might be. So I'm learning all of this for the first time. You cannot imagine my shock the first time I saw my mother fly across the room. You know why? Because she's not Superwoman. Do you know why, Emily? She took flying lessons?
No.
She did not take flying lessons because she was abused.
That was the first time I saw her fly this way, and I saw her fly that way. My mother is 4'11". Maybe, well, she's up there in age now. Maybe she's like 110 pounds soaking wet now. She's a tiny little thing. I was so shocked when I saw that happen. And it got worse from there. Any attempts for my sister and I to help her were met with brutal force from her husband. Unfortunately, what he learned during these episodes was that if he would abuse my mother enough and hurt her enough, that he could send her to the hospital and he could have free reign with her daughters. And he did. Many of the things that I saw in my home at the hands of people who were my family were unbelievable to me, but I told no one. I told no one. Because our migrant life continued, we continued to move. I had no friends. I had no teacher who I felt close enough to tell. I didn't know that I could seek help from a counselor. No one was assisting my mother. Looking back at that time now, I understand the necessity for mental health. I understand
that someone needed to step in to help my mother. I understand that someone needed to step in to help us, but that wasn't the situation. I would tell you more about the things that happened there, but it's in the book. But what I'm saying to you, the reason I share that with you, is because I look out in this room and I know that I'm not the only one. Because I have spoken to hundreds of thousands of people across this country and in other countries, and I have never been in a room where I'm the only one. Because things got worse in my home, and because I am the oldest in my family, I felt a great sense of necessity and responsibility to my family to help them. But I could not stay in that home any longer. At the age of 17, I dropped out of high school. I was so sick and tired of everything that was happening in my home, sick and tired of my mother telling me what to do, the teachers telling me what to do, her husband telling me what to do. Everybody was getting on my freaking nerves, so I did what anybody else in their right mind could have possibly done. I joined the Army. Because nobody tells you what to do there. Whoa, what was I thinking? Actually, that was one of the best decisions I ever made in my life. Because once I got to boot camp, everybody was yelling and screaming and hollering, do this, do that, do whatever. And everybody was like, oh my God, they're yelling at me. Oh my God, I can't believe it. Oh my God. And I'm like, what are you crying about? Nobody's hitting you. I thought, you are so lame. Get over it. Just go do it. What's wrong with you? So for me, the military was a perfect fit. I was recruited very, very, very early on for a leadership position. And so I went into training immediately. By the time I hadn't even hit 20, and I was leading co-ed troops. It was very, very beneficial to my life, and it helped in the trajectory of my life. However, what was missing for me, I could not gain rank because I had not gone to school. And so when they approached me about that, my drill sergeant at that time, my commander, said, you know, call me Ruzi, because my last name was Ruiz, and I don't know how I got Ruzi out of that. He said, hey, Ruzi, you're going to have to go back to school. And I'm like, no, I don't do school. Because my history with school was so treacherous, there was no way I was going to go back and do that. He said, oh, no, you are. I'm like, oh, no, I'm not. And so, I didn't say it out loud, of course, I mean, I have a brain, come on. So, anyway, he put me on a mission, and he sent me on a couple of details. Yeah, I cracked a couple of thousand eggs, cleaned up about 20 bathrooms one weekend. And they actually do make you use a toothbrush to clean out the grout on the tiles. Yeah, and I was like, you know what, school maybe wasn't that bad. Yeah. But I say that in jest, because what happened was, they didn't send me back. And at that time, I was stationed in South Carolina, and I was sent to Texas. And I really, really believe that it was by the grace of God that I got to go to Texas. And so I was stationed there. So I went to Texas, and I enrolled at Texas Tech University. My roommate at the time wanted me to go with her to some Kappa, Delta, Chi, something. I said, seriously, look at me. Does it look like I want to go with you? I had just been stationed in the military in South Carolina, and this girl thinks I want to go to a sorority thing? No. And so she said, no, please, 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 can you please just go with me? She says, you know, if you can just go with me to the rush part, and then, you know, then I can meet some people, and then you don't have to go with me anymore. And I'm like, yeah, no.
And then I thought, well, she was actually really nice to me. Okay, all right, I guess. I said, but don't get happy, because I'm not going to like it. And I'm not going to be nice. And those people better not be trying to talk to me. She said, no, just go with me. Just sit with me for a second, and then I'll talk to people, and then you can leave. And I'm like, all right. I said, they have food? Yes. Let's go. And so that moment in the spring of 1989 changed my life forever. I went to Rush and I met Zsa Zsa Gabor, otherwise known as, you know who I'm talking about. Because you know her as Cindy. And she had this pink, fluffy boa, and she had this hair that was going everywhere, and she had this really, like, fuchsia pink lipstick on. She said, girls! And I looked at Juanita, I'm like, seriously? No. And so I was like, I'm gonna go sit down right over here. And then here comes Nellie. Hi, girls! Do you know Nellie? Okay, that's almost like her pitch, right?
Is that right, Cindy?
Yeah. Yeah. I said, oh, what fakers. I'm already getting nauseous. Just the thought of it. So I'm sitting there, and they're talking to me, or attempting to talk to me. Actually, if I were them, I would have booted me already, because I've got such a horrible attitude about it. But they were so incredibly kind. They were, like, interested in what I had to say. That was very, very unusual to me. So I said, we're a bunch of fakers. And so before I knew it was time to go home, back to our dorms. And I'm like, well, done with that. I don't want anything to do with those people. They're a bunch of fakers, people being that nice to everyone, tugging on you, saying goodbye, see you later. Yeah, no, not doing it. Said the idiot 26 years later. The unfortunate thing, or the curious thing, was I got invited back and my roommate didn't. I was like, no. Because at that time they would slide the invitations under our door. And so they slid it under the door, and I thought it was for her, so I just gave it to Juanita, and she goes, it's not mine. And I was like, well, whose is it? So I look at her, I'm like, no, and no. She goes, oh, please. You ought to meet her. She's pretty persuasive. Anyway, she said, oh, please just go. If you'll just do it this year, then I'll know somebody for next year. Yeah, I'm still waiting for that next year. So why did I keep going back? Why did I keep going back? Because what? Because they accepted me just as I am. They saw me with all my uglies, and they loved me. They were kind, they were generous, they were interested, and they were about service. They gave with everything in them. I also came to understand that semester how absolutely courageous those four women were in doing what they had done. Those of you that are not from Lubbock, Texas, because there's only a few of us here, first of all, my other alpha sister.
Hello, where is she?
Hello! Come on, be loud, come on. Those of you that are not from Lubbock, Texas, you may not understand this. And so as I thought about what I would say to you, I knew today that in order to do this, I had to go back here. Because there is no place like home for me. And my home, just as I mentioned in the book, is with my sisters, with the sisterhood that has been provided by the courage of these four women. What you may or may not know and may have taken for granted is how much scrutiny these four women went through. I don't want to begin to tell you how much
ridicule they had to hear. How people would make fun of us and call us the Katie Cows. How they did not want a group of minority women to be successful on that campus. However, they would not accept us in their organizations. They did not want us at their football games. They didn't want us sitting in the student section. They didn't want us whenever they had the student body meetings. We were not accepted there. But these women decided to go forth and figure out a way to find a place for all of us. And when they did that, they stayed focused on what was important to them. And I will say this to you because I think it's important that you understand the value of the history of our organization and how it has served to strengthen who we are. The main source for them and their strength was our God. In everything that we did, there was prayer. In everything that we thought of doing, there was prayer. In every life that we hoped to touch, there was prayer. Our prayer was that God would send us to serve those who needed us. At the same time, serve each other. What I have learned through the years is that it's that same feeling in which many, many of my sisters have been there to serve me in time of need. I remember the days of drawing and working on that shield. I remember working in the UC specifically. Okay, so we had to fight a little bit. It wasn't major about what would be on there. It is no mistake. There is no mistake on that shield. Everything was with purpose. Every part of it. Everything that has to go in our mission and our purpose, everything that happened even after that when we had to start making bylaws. And these things didn't just happen, did they, Naomi? These were painful things. And as you all know, a big piece that was important that was on that shield was the spiritual aspect of what we do. I say that piece to you specifically because people would think, well, they're only a bunch of Mexicans getting together trying to have a sorority. And I remember someone saying that. But I also remember a young lady, and some of you may or may not know this, a young lady from India, and her name was Anita Rao. And she worked with us in the UC as we worked on the shield. It was obvious she wasn't Christian, but she wanted to be part of our organization because we accepted her. Anita Rawl had a serious kidney disease and actually died not long after that. And we remembered her fondly because of what she taught us. And it's not necessarily about the religion, it's about your relationship with who you believe your higher being is. It's about being good and true. And so when I think about going back home for me and why I stay focused on what we do, I think about what is our purpose. Whenever Taryn asked me to prepare this speech, she asked me to think about what I would say about what has led to my success and how I can encourage you to be successful. There is no way that a person that was a high school dropout gets to live the life that I have been very fortunate to live. There is absolutely no way that someone coming from where I have come from gets to be with the people that I get to learn from and live with. I didn't want to finish high school, so you can't imagine how shocked I still am when I think about having graduate degrees from Harvard twice. Because it can happen, but it's not going to come easy, and you will have to work for it. And it's this purpose right here in our beloved sisterhood that has given that to me. And our purpose is what? I hope you could read this with me, and you should know what it is, so please help me. The purpose of Kappa Delta Chi is to promote the values of
unity, honesty, integrity, and leadership among women at colleges and universities.
It doesn't seem that hard. Four tens. How many times do we take the time to really think about them and internalize them and question yourself, am I living what I have claimed our purpose to be? Have you? I don't know. Only you can answer that. And we must answer it daily. When we think about our first one, we think about our unity. What actually combines all of us? What connects us? Why do I see you and I know that I love you? How do I know that? Because we are joined by this purpose. And what is that purpose? It's a connectedness by our humanness. And how we know that together, if you wear these letters, I'm knowing, I'm trusting that someone trained you and taught you everything that you must know, and that you have committed to knowing why we do what we do, and that we will remain focused on the mission of service to others. When we look and think about honesty, I'm talking true honesty, not the fluffy, oh, your hair looks great.
Is it a wig?
No, I'm talking true honesty. And honesty sometimes is painful. But we're talking about speaking truth in the spirit of openness and in love. Open to be able to say to you what must be said so that we stay focused and aligned with the mission of this sisterhood. We must become aligned again. When I hear of the different things, and many of you have spoken to me about different things, please don't think that any of it is new. I've been in this organization for 20 plus years. We've seen a lot of stuff, right, Naomi? Yes. It's not new, but we can help each other. We can help each other get through these tough times, but we too must be open to the fact that sometimes we are the problem. But being honest and communicating that with love is crucial to what we do, because we claim to be doing it always. Integrity. Now, this is one that we're going to step on a little toes on. By we, I mean me. Going to step on some toes here. Because, yes, I understand that I was only, 18, 19 years old when I decided to join the sisterhood. And 44 years old is knocking on my door right now. But somehow I didn't know that the definition of integrity had changed. You must self-govern yourself in the area of integrity. When we think of integrity, I'm talking about adherence to moral and ethical principles for the way that you treat others and the way you treat yourself and the way you display yourself. The soundness of our moral character, whether we like it or not, is being judged always. And I hate to admit this, and it is true, and I say it in honesty, but I've actually had to unfriend some of my Katie Kai sisters by some of the abuses on social networking tools. I am a professional on the global level. Do you honestly think that I think it's appropriate for my name to be tied to some of these things that I see on there? And you think, well, that's your problem, not mine. It will be yours too when you decide to get your act together and put yourself in a professional situation and advance your career for the empowerment of Latino women and for our communities. Now, I know that Naomi and Ruby were probably thinking, who let her have that microphone? You're on that. But it's not you, and they're not surprised. And they're not surprised. Because when we had to think about professional dress, whether or not we wore pantyhose, who do you think said we needed closed-toed shoes? What I'm saying is,
If you honestly think that we're not held to a higher standard, you are wrong. And I don't believe that being held to a higher standard is difficult, because I know everything in me tells me we can meet it and exceed it. And so it doesn't matter what standard is set, we will go higher. And so as we think of leadership, because that's really where I think we can continue to grow. Our sisterhood has been a leader in many, many different capacities for years. We continue to lead in the national level. We continue to lead in our families, our homes, our communities, our jobs. We will continue to do this. Anywhere that I go across this country, I just ask them, do we have any sisters here? And yes, we do. We have people everywhere. A group of interns came to my office a couple of weeks ago, and so we're sitting there talking. We're talking high caliber young people coming in a very competitive market to be interns up on the Hill in different political places, at the White House, in our office, and I see there this wonderful young lady, and I am just not surprised one bit that she is, yes ma'am, because we are everywhere. But in order to continue to be in this role and continue in this trajectory to make an example and to have our name known with excellence, we must understand that with this leadership comes responsibility. And so when we look about whether or not a person is a leader, do not say, oh, well, I'm not on the national board, or I'm not on a committee, or I'm just a this, or I'm just a that. Wrong. You wearing these letters, you are leading someone somewhere. You must stand up and accept that task. You must sit up straight. You must know what you're saying. In the workshop that we had in negotiations yesterday, how many people came to that? Are any of you in here? It's about understanding that you have it in you. You have those gifts already. Those are God-given gifts, but you need to share them. And when you're out there sharing them, you must understand that you must walk the walk. We don't get to say we're a sisterhood with an idea of serving others, and then we complain when we have to go do service. Because what is that? Am I gonna get credit for that? Well, I'm about to give you credit. Or would you like it? Please understand that I am your sister. Understand that I have a daughter coming your way. I need to know and trust, just as all of you, that when I release her to you, she's in good hands. I need to believe that. I need to know that the day that I met Zsa Zsa Gabor was real. It was true. She was the real thing. Don't tell me different. And so, I say all of that to you, and I hope that you will receive it in the spirit in which I'm giving it to you. We have been tremendously blessed, and God has shown great favor over this great organization and the women in it. And He will continue to lead you and guide you, but we must continue to seek His guidance. And so with that, I wanted to just share a couple of memories, just right quick, with you. As you look at these, understand that these memories are my memories, and the pictures are of some of you in here and some that are no longer with us. But they're just pictures of sisters, and those sisters are actually your sisters here. So one thing that we used to do a lot with our prayer, and it's actually scripturally based, that we kiss each other when we see each other. That is actually 1 Thessalonians, that you greet each other with a kiss. And we don't do that so much anymore. And not that I'm asking you to go kissing everybody, but could you give them a hug when you see this, if it just moves you to do that?
But then when the song ends, I do expect you to sit back down. I only have one more slide, and then I promise, Taryn, I'm going to sit down. Very thankful for your friendship because you're the best friends anyway.